Alan Gordon doesn't play. Mummy was one of the few politicians, I think, that was in it for the good of everybody else. Genuinely wanted to see good things happen, and it wasn't, well, what I could do for myself or what I could do for my family, as the case may be.
A woman of substance and integrity. The ideal role model.
Marilyn Bailey Gordon, one of the first female ministers of government in the history of Trinidad and Tobago, and an original member of Eric Williams's famous kitchen cabinet. The political rise of this stalwart of the political stage and her contribution to national development marks her as an exemplar. Even in her formative years, Gordon was a model for many by virtue of her academic and sporting accomplishments. Most notably, at the tender age of 15, Gordon gained selection to the senior national hockey team, becoming then the youngest person ever to represent a national senior sports team, an achievement that stands even to this day. This journey to academic and sporting excellence began in 1942.
I was born in Success Village, Raventhal, in 1942. I'm the eldest of four children. And we left Success Village when I was about five, and we went to live in Upper Cascade. And I went to the Providence Girls Intermediate. I stayed there until I did the exhibition. I won an exhibition from Providence. I think I was the second girl to win an exhibition from Providence. I went to Bishop Ansley High School. By the time I got to lower five, which is the equivalent of fourth form, I was selected to represent Trinidad at hockey. I was playing, we were playing netball at school, we were playing hockey. I picked to represent Trinidad at hockey. And I went off to play hockey in Jamaica in the, what used to be the Triangle Tournament, the Colonial Tournament it was called in those days. And after that, well, I was the youngest player. And I was still the youngest player. I think I'm still the youngest player ever to have represented Trinidad. And my first warm-up match was a disaster because I found out afterwards that I didn't fly very good. Well, and in those days, you flew from Trinidad to Caracas. And then you took, and it used to take 6 hours to get from Caracas to Kingston. And so I got off the plane and didn't realize it, but my reflexes were off and everything. So in that warm-up game, I got, I think, 10 goals or something. And of course, the natives in Jamaica were very happy. The Guyanese were very happy. Trinidadians were very worried. But it turned out to be all right. Because I went, when I came back from the match, I went and I spent about 4 hours that night and 4 hours in the morning, the next morning, on a table tennis board until I got my rhythm back. So then they didn't score on me again for the tournament.
Gordon continued to excel in academics and sports in the United Kingdom at the University of Newcastle upon Tyne, where she pursued her tertiary level education. And she attained an honours degree even while representing the university in the sporting disciplines of hockey, netball, and athletics. Upon her return to Trinidad, Gordon started her professional life as an educator, but soon received a higher calling to national service. She was soon drawn into the world of active politics, even at great sacrifice to family.
Going into politics meant that you were working long hours. You were away from the family. My son was 4 at the time. You were away from the family. I wasn't there to supervise the homework and all of that every night. But it also gave an opportunity to serve the country.
She was so into the politics that she didn't really have much time or energy for anything else. We kind of just went with her. You know, I could count on one hand, less than, I don't even need all the fingers on one hand to count all the vacations we took as a family or the times we spent outside of politics saying, hey, let's go, you know, to Tobago, or hey, let's go down south and Lyme. You know, if mommy was in a line by her friends, they were talking politics. If she home, the phone was ringing, she has something to do with, you know, with her job. If she was going out, she was going out to a function, a meeting, official appearance as minister of whatever. it was kind of a package is a package deal. Mommy is politics, politics is mommy. Though there's no, in my head, there's never a separation. There's always, you know, like I was, must be 10 or 11 and helping her write speeches and edit speeches and get ready for meetings and pick out outfits and tell her which shoes I find go with which dress, like go to all the meetings. It's literally my whole life, my whole childhood is just politics, literally.
And the nation benefited from the sacrifices made by Gordon because of her strong work ethic, which guided her commitment to excellence and getting results.
Her passion for what she does is really the hallmark of her existence. She undertakes nothing that she does not feel strongly about, because then she wouldn't be able to put 100% into it. And she is definitely 100%.
They think of sport and education. It's very interesting. I suppose I served my longest tenure in both of those ministries as minister. The sports people remember it, I suppose, because of the changes that we brought, that we were able to get done. Those were the days when we had established a policy for national sporting organizations and how they could come to the government and get money, what we would support, how we would support them, and so on. So a lot of the people involved in sport remember that, and most people. The people who were involved in education remember me in education. One of the things they remember most is the fact that I fought with Anthony Garcia over getting teachers to go to school 2 days before the end of the holidays. I had taught in government schools, and I had taught in assisted primary and secondary schools. At the assisted secondary schools, the teachers were required to come out during the vacation. You come out early to prepare for the new term. But that didn't happen in the government schools. And it certainly didn't happen, I don't think, in the primary schools, but certainly in the secondary schools. I found as a teacher that it was the most useful exercise, because it meant that you started off the first day of term running, and you made maximum use of the 13 weeks, because it's 13 weeks basically every term. And of course, well, I was asking people to give up 2 days of their holiday. So it wasn't a very popular decision, and I refused to back down. You know? I'm just one of those kind of people, I refused to back down. And I said, those teachers who didn't come out wouldn't get paid for the holiday, because that is the agreement. Right? If you don't turn up to school on the first day of school in those days, then you weren't entitled to your vacation pay. So they came out with much kicking and screaming, and then a lot of them found that it really worked. So I understand it still goes on. They all go to work. Dr. Williams established what he called the kitchen cabinet, which was comprised of all the women in the parliament. So it was the ministers, Norma Lewis Phillip, Elmina Clark Allen, the other one of the Muriel Donovo, and myself as the ministers. And then we had Amoy Mohammed, who was a parliamentary secretary, and Joan Seeley, who was the member of parliament for Laventille. And we were our main function was to deal with the social problems. We ran into some interesting experiences, let's put it that way. On the one hand, we had the feminist movement, the members of the feminist movement, vexed because it was called a kitchen cabinet. Dr. Lenz had explained to us that in his house, the major decisions were taken around the kitchen table, with his mother in charge. Father was there, and everybody had their say, but the mother was in charge. And what he wanted was to get these women together to work on those programs. We had, remember, in those days, we didn't have a school feeding program as yet. He had introduced the school feeding program, but it wasn't going anywhere because, you know, people weren't interested in that kind of thing. We wanted to get the childhood, early childhood centers going, and those kinds of problems, the problems that the women were facing as women. Part of the problem was the shift system with the kids coming home on afternoons and running around doing whatever. The important thing for me was not the name of the group. The important thing for me was the fact that this group made their recommendations directly to the chairman of the cabinet, who was the prime minister. So I was the chairman of the group. And we would make our recommendations, send them to the prime minister, and he would take them to cabinet. And got them approved. And because we were responsible for getting implemented, we did the work. So we were, but people were making a noise because they call it kitchen cabinet. And I'm saying, well, let's look beyond that. Let's see what we're supposed to do and how can you help us do what you're allowed. Well, it didn't help. That particular group didn't help. They don't normally help. They just talk plenty anyhow. But we were able to get that school feeding program off the ground. And that was a stage where I think we were feeding about 50,000 children a day. We established kitchens all over the country. Got women into work because they were running the kitchens and so on and so forth. Helped change the diet of kids because we introduced a lot of the local foods. We got experiments done and so on. And so we were able to get children to start eating pumpkin bread or banana bread, or, you know, that kind of thing.
Her whole tenure in sports, culture and youth affairs was a lot of things were founded then that still carry on within those disciplines today, which at the time I didn't really realize anything big was going on. It's only now that I look back and I still see this program and that program going on, I think to myself, wow, mommy really set up a good foundation that I end up benefiting from.
Gordon learned many lessons from politics about the people of Trinidad and Tobago and their expectations of their leaders. Lessons that can inform those aspiring to high political office.
The people of Trinidad and Tobago are, by and large, very sensible, know what they want, very tolerant, except when you have overdone it. It's taught me that this country is probably one of the best places on planet Earth to live, and that you will always be able to get a helping hand. At least in my day it was like that. You would always get a helping hand once you were honest with people. For me, it was a lesson in why you need to listen when people speak as a group.
Marilyn Gordon, politician and much more. In many regards, she was the trailblazer for female ministers of government in Trinidad and Tobago. And although long retired from active representative politics, she has and continues to make a positive mark on the national landscape.
She is a very giving, loving, generous person. Like, the one thing I've learned from my mother is to extend yourself as much as you can to everybody else, to the country, to people that you could help. Any, to this day, anybody that my mother could lend a helping hand to, she does. Because she's so well known as Marilyn Gordon, the minister and the politician, I think people either forget or overlook what she did as a scholar and what she did as a sportswoman. You know, because she's like a Hall of Famer in various disciplines, scholarship winner. But people don't really think that when you think Marilyn. When you think Marilyn Gordon, you think she was minister of X, Y, and Z in such and such years.
After all of these years out of politics, we would be liming, and people would come up to her, Mrs. Gordon, that is you? And I could see that she doesn't readily remember the person. The person would say, but you won't remember me, you know, but in such and such a year, you helped my child, you did this, you did that. And given the memory span of Trinidadians, to me it's very significant that decades after she has left politics, nobody says anything negative about her. She's one of the few people who have passed through politics in this country with her reputation unscathed.
Marilyn Gordon is a really misunderstood human being. I think, I mean, she don't play, she's not a joker, she's not about about small things. She's about getting the job done, whatever the job may be, that in the way that is best for everybody. But she's a really generous, caring person that constantly is giving and giving and giving of herself. And I don't think people pick that up off of her.